in Mapleton, Minnesota, on Sirius 130. You're on Catholic Answers Live with Robert Royal. Hey, Jonah.
Hi. Thanks for taking my call tonight. I am curious about a phenomenon called mythopoesis. I guess it involves writers like George MacDonald and Tolkien and maybe C.S. Lewis to a certain extent, and their emphasis is on approaching truth through the imagination. So sort of the sacramentality of the imagination. And I'm curious about what the place of that imagination is in the Catholic intellectual life, and if I can maybe specify it even more. The idea of being able to make worlds in terms of fantasy writing, to be able to make worlds that don't literally exist, but to be able to glorify God through things that in and of themselves you couldn't find in reality, but that draw on the truths of reality. To what extent do we see this ability to subcreate and this power of imagination as something that God has called us to use to become holier? I'm really curious about that.
Is that a yes or no question, Jonah?
Is that a yes or no question?
No, of course it isn't. Just an awful lot to chew on. Did you get your arms around that?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah.
I have a long section about Tolkien in my book because, Tolkien, to the annoyance of lots of modern literary critics and professors, is the most influential writer of the 20th century. He's sold an enormous number of books, but also it's just influential for the very reason that you're talking about, that mythopoesis of the type you're talking about exists at a time when it would be very difficult to baldly present Catholic or Christian ideas. And so what you do is you convey, by the very structure of a world that exists, a sense of reality that's much richer than the thinner rationalist reality that we live in right now. Now, there's a whole series of debates. I'm on the board of a very interesting magazine called Image up in Seattle. It's located up in Seattle right now, and its editor and I are very close. We go back decades together, even though I hope we're both still young men. And he likes to talk about the indirectness and the kind of the still small voice that you need at this point in our history. I wrote a book about Dante because one of my in an earlier life I was studying to be a kind of a scholar of Dante's Divine Comedy. And of course in the Middle Ages you could present Catholic ideas and the whole range of heaven, hell, earth, purgatory in an explicit way that is unmistakable. But now, in our time, a Dante, I think you could make the case that Tolkien is about as close to a Dante as we have. A Dante wanting to convey those truths has to be, as James Joyce once said, a practitioner of silence, exile, and cunning. You know, we have to find a way around these
obstacles. I'm writing that down.
Yeah. We have to find a way around these obstacles that the culture has put there. And we can't, for a variety of reasons, if you go directly at them, you'll be rejected. But if you're truly a practitioner of subcreation, as Tolkien thought of it. In other words, since we're made, was it Lewis who had the poem? No, it was Tolkien who has the poem. We make in the image in which we were made. Mm. You know, so it's a continuation of God's creative power. It's not against him the way, you know, some Promethean modern artists are. It isn't just irreality because it is a expression of, it presents a world to us that explains our own world with kind of, without being a mirror image or realism, it still shows us insights into who we are over and beyond those obstacles that maybe our culture has placed before our eyes.
How's that, Jonah?
That's beautiful. Can I ask, one sort of follow-up question, or is this enough for time?
For a huge fee, go ahead.
All right, thanks. In your own life as a human being and an artist, to what extent do you see your imagination sanctifying you and your role of subcreating sanctifying you?
You know what I would say about this is that I'll put it in a kind of a philosophical, theological sense. When I was younger, I was a great devotee of Maritain and of St. Thomas and of that whole Aristotelian scholastic tradition because I think one thing that a lot of people feel is that the world is chaotic. Young people feel it's chaotic, and you need the stability of that. As I get older, and of course I have longer history and more confidence about the tradition, I see the kind of Platonic, Augustinian, storytelling, creative side as, for me, more urgent. And I'm sometimes surprised. My wife read this book, and of course, I've almost been married 40 years, and she said, where did you get all this stuff? I've known you all this time, and where did you find this stuff? So it's the spirit. I can't claim much credit for it.
Thanks for the call, John.